Hey, stargazers, welcome back. My name is Nick. I'm a theaters manager at the Adler Planetarium, and you're watching Skywatch Weekly. Well, this week we've got more interesting planets in the dawn sky, also the closest pairing of Mars and the Pleiades for the next 17 years, and we've also got some interesting sights to look for in the daytime sky, because of course skywatching doesn't have to end when the sun comes up. First, though, the dawn sky continues to be a busy place this week. We're going to start looking east-southeast tomorrow morning about 45 minutes before sunrise. Last week I mentioned the trio of Jupiter, Saturn, and Mercury. Jupiter and Saturn continue to get higher and higher each morning, but Mercury is beginning its dive sunward, so you'll need to catch it while you can. On the morning of Friday the 5th, Mercury will pass very close to Jupiter from our vantage point on Earth, with the two planets appearing within 1/3 of a degree of each other. You might recall that Jupiter and Saturn's historically close pass in December was 1/10 of a degree. This isn't quite that close, and it'll be much harder to see in the pre-dawn sky, but tomorrow morning on the 4th through the morning of the 6th, Mercury and Jupiter will be within 1 degree of each other. Jupiter is quite bright and should be easily seen with the naked eye in the pre-dawn sky. Mercury will be a little bit harder to spot, especially as dawn approaches, but binoculars or a low-power telescope will definitely help. You might get the added bonus of some of Jupiter's moons thrown in for good measure. After this particularly close pass, stick around on the mornings of the 9th and the 10th as the thin crescent moon joins these planets. It's a week full of picturesque planets, perhaps not at the most opportune time, but if you're up 30 to 45 minutes before sunrise, take a peek at this view before daybreak. Well, from the morning to the evening sky, we're looking at Mars and the Pleiades star cluster. They continue to be quite close this week. We're looking southwest here about an hour after sunset. The closest pairing, just over 2.5 degrees apart, happens tomorrow night, March 4th. 2.5 degrees is close enough for a binocular field of view, but the pairing is also beautiful just with your eyes. As I mentioned last week, these two haven't been so closely paired in the sky since 2006, and it'll be another 17 years until they're this close again. Even if you don't catch the pairing tomorrow night, they'll still be within a binocular field of view for another week or so. But one of the cool things about skywatching is the fact that it isn't confined to the nighttime sky. That is what most people think about when they consider looking skyward, but there's a surprising amount of cool stuff to see before the stars come out. For instance, right at sunset or sunrise is a great time to see what's known as the belt of Venus. In the minutes after sunset or the minutes before sunrise, look in the opposite direction of the sun and look for a pinkish or yellowish band of light horizontal to the horizon. That's called the belt of Venus, which is caused by sunlight being backscattered by particles in the atmosphere. The longer after sunset, the higher this band of light will appear in the sky, and directly below it is a dark blue layer. What you're seeing there is Earth's shadow extending back away from the sun through the atmosphere. As the twilight deepens, you are getting deeper into Earth's shadow as Earth rotates and eventually night falls. Sunset is also a great time to look for crepuscular and anti-crepuscular rays. These lines of shadow and light can be caused by clouds, buildings, or mountains, and can appear across the sky. Those that appear to point back to the sun are crepuscular, and those that converge away from it are called anti-crepuscular. The word crepuscule is another word for twilight. Rays of light and shadow from the sun can also appear when the sun is fully up, and these are then more generally known as sunbeams. Another phenomenon that can appear when the sun is fully up are known as sundogs, or parhelia. These patches of light on either side of the sun are caused by ice crystals suspended in the atmosphere. On days with high cirrus clouds, they're quite common. They usually appear in pairs, one on each side of the sun, at a distance of about 22 degrees. Why 22 degrees? Well, that's the angle that light is refracted as it passes through these ice crystals. Red light is refracted at a slightly different angle than blue light. That's something we see in rainbows. So if you see some coloration in the sundog, the red color will be closest to the sun, and the edge farther from the sun will be bluish. This effect can also extend fully around the sun, causing a sun halo. The moon can also exhibit halos, although these are much dimmer and harder to see. Well, speaking of the moon, it's another daytime skywatching object to look for. And this week is the perfect time. The 10 days or so after a full moon, the waning moon will be up in the sky after sunrise. Over the next week, give a look for the thinner and thinner moon in the morning sky. On the morning of Friday the 5th and Saturday the 6th, the moon will be about due south at sunrise and won't set until about 10 a.m. here in Chicago. The third quarter daytime moon is a perfectly good telescope target. It won't show quite the contrast that it does in the dark sky, but plenty of good detail should be visible. Just do be extremely careful not to point your telescope anywhere near the sun. Unless you know what you're doing and have the right equipment, you could very seriously hurt your eyes. Planets like Venus and Jupiter are also visible in the daytime if you know just where to look. This is made much easier by using a stargazing app during the daytime. Jupiter is pretty well placed for this right now, and in the morning of the 10th, the thin crescent moon could be a big help in figuring out where to find Jupiter in that blue sky. So my challenge for you this week is to spot the daytime moon. You don't have to get up early or stay up late. Just pick a clear morning after sunrise and give a look for the moon. Each day it'll be a little bit thinner and a little bit closer to the sun. Well, that's what we have for you this week. Thanks, as always, for watching. If you haven't yet, make sure you hit the subscribe button to get all the latest content from the Adler Planetarium. And also don't forget to follow us on social media. Happy skywatching, and we'll see you next week.